So the Halloween costume this year was a pretty big success. Decided to make a brief video detailing some of the work that went into it, crediting some of the people who helped me, and then answering some of the questions I've been getting. Overall, pretty impressive costume, but the two things that stood out to most people was the giant arm-mounted double Gatling gun, which was based very loosely on a project done by Backyard Effects. And the second eye-catcher of the costume, especially when it was dark, was the evil-looking glowing holographic monocle with sort of a steampunk-inspired gear design on the side of it. I got the idea originally from a guy named Sigma, who designs things of this nature. The links to both the Sigma eyepiece and the Backyard Effects gun are in the description. Now, in the interest of being realistic as well as lightweight, we ditched cardboard as a potential material pretty early on in the project. Here we see the 4-inch 6-barrel design made out of PVC, which was later downsized to a 3-inch 5-barrel design. One of the features I wanted the gun to have was not only rotating barrels, but counter-rotating barrels. That kind of weeded out the idea of pulleys being the drivetrain, so we ditched them in favor of gears. Matthias Wandel of woodgears.ca, he's sort of an eccentric woodworking genius, has a program that allows you to cut gears out of wood. You basically print the gear off and you can cut it with a table saw. I ditched this idea because it seemed like a lot of work, so I went to the CNC press at my friends at St. James Technologies, and we decided wood was a bad medium to cut it with, so I went ahead and bought his full version, which allowed us to export to CAD. We decided to try our hand with ABS plastic. And here we see Matt doing some final modifications to the program and the gear itself. We were very happy with the way it came out. The ABS plastic was an excellent choice. In addition to being incredibly rugged, it was also lightweight and very precise too. Here you see the powertrain, which would be just simply a cordless screwdriver. We chose some 3/4 very lightweight tubing and threaded it through the 3-inch thin-walled PVC caps. Here you see them resting atop their respective gears. We knew from the start that we were going to use some roller skate bearings to turn everything on, so when we machined the gears, the center of the hole was machined a couple thousandths too small to allow for tapping in the bearings easily. Now the holes in the bearings were 5/16, so after a little bit of digging, we decided on a pair of old baby bed guide rods. They worked really well, and I was pretty pleased with the progress so far until I realized I had no way of impressing a bearing-sized hole on the 3-inch pipe cap. Being very far away from the drill and very close to the deadline, I decided to go with a much less elegant way of doing things. Grabbing a blowtorch, I basically superheated an old bearing and shoved it through the molten plastic, creating a bearing-sized hole. It took a couple tries and we ruined several of them, but we finally melted a couple holes that were close enough to the center to match the precision of the rest of the project. Once I was happy with the way it spun, it was time to find a way to keep it on the guide rod without falling off. To this end, I employed several cotter pins that were shoved through small holes that we drilled in the guide rod. And with the help of some spacers, we were able to secure the spinning part of the gun onto the guide rod without it moving. And after that, we were ready for some paint. Using some Goo Gone, I removed all the price tags and stickers off of it, and used some steel wool to rough the surface up to prep it for the paint. Once the paint was dry, we attached both the barrels and the arm brace to the superstructure, which was made out of cut-up pieces of aluminum tubing from an old TV antenna. Although the barrels were screwed on, we decided to pop rivet the piece of scrap pressboard flooring that we used for the arm brace, just for structural strength. If you look closely in the sequence, you can see the interaction and the mounting of the small gears. One, of course, is attached to the cordless screwdriver being bolted down, and you can see the other one required a time-consuming special bracket to be made for it. At this point in the project, we were very stretched for time, so I took a live bait bucket, cut it in half, and painted it black. You can see it on the table. I'm filing furiously on a PVC compression coupling, which I'm going to insert the laser into. The pressure switch for the green tactical laser that we were going to use for the Gatling gun was broken, so at the last minute I had to call my Uncle Gary over and get him to solder the switch back into a usable form. After shoving the newly operational laser into the pressure coupling and mounting it to the gun, I slid the sawed-off bait bucket over the arm brace to hide all of the operational parts. After all this was accomplished, we rushed out to the backyard for a final coat of black paint. The paint I used was a spray-on chalkboard, which gave it a nice matte black finish. And here you can see me on D-Day, 30 minutes before we left the hotel, still monkeying around and trying to fix up last-minute flaws and reconcile some oversights, such as having absolutely no way to attach the finished product to my arm. The solution finally came in the form of several zip ties and a sock, which provided a workable, albeit uncomfortable, way for me to carry it all night. In the second part of the video, we'll be looking at the monocle, which contains a pulsating holographic eye and is adorned with some steampunk-inspired gearing on the side of it. Again, going back a couple days, we find ourselves again at St. James Technologies, where they struggle to have a normal work week with my project shenanigans going on around them. We used several things to construct the eye. The actual eye piece was made out of PVC and custom molded to fit my eye. For the lighting, we used surface-mounted LEDs. Here you see Jonathan soldering some wires onto them. For the actual holographic eye, we disassembled some eyeglasses that we found in a costume store. Now, initially, we wanted the LED to do quite a few things, but towards the end, as the timeline came down, we just decided with a simple pulsing on and off, we were using Gravitech's little nano board, which was a great little board. Here you see Jonathan programming the brightness cycles on. This is the pulsing action with a single LED. We did not like the way that it made the eye triangular and sort of weak looking. So to address this, we went ahead and soldered two more LEDs onto the eyepiece, bringing the total to three. The extra lighting really fleshed out the hologram quite nicely, and we decided to go with that. After securing the wires with a prodigious amount of hot glue, we decided to move on to the gearing. We initially wanted to slow down the engine and regulate the voltage by doing some sort of phase pulse modulation, but we decided eventually to go with a simpler inline resistor solution. Once we determined that we were happy with the way things were pulsing and spinning, John went ahead and made the final solders and wrapped it up with electrical tape. The eyepiece would eventually be colored in pleather, and the gears would eventually be painted to match the costume. The whole unit was powered by a 9-volt battery and hid securely in my hat. Here we see a shot of the final product, complete with spinning gears and fluorescent angry eye.
This is Daniel still in the hotel working on his costume. He's not done.
Yet.
Alright, essentially I just want a way to carry it. So I'm gonna have to make a handle.